Good morning, students. I am Krishan Kumar, your physics teacher. Today we will start our chapter 10 in 11th class physics. The name of chapter is Mechanical Properties of Fluid. This is very important chapter, and this is a little bit long chapter, and it carries almost 7 to 8 marks in your final exams. So in this chapter we are going to cover first pressure. What is pressure, its application and its uses in daily life. Simply pressure you have studied in lower classes also. Then type of flow, means liquid which can flow. They may have number of type of flow that a liquid can flow. Next is Bernoulli principle. It is the basic principle which is used to flow in a liquid, to study the flow of a liquid or to study the motion of any object in a fluid. Then viscosity, it is nothing but the type of friction present in the liquid. Reynolds number will tell about the type of flow of a liquid, and the surface tension, yani ki property of a liquid to compress itself, to acquire minimum surface area for the maximum volume. So these are the topic which we have to study in chapter 10, that is mechanical properties of fluid. So let's start our chapter. So first is pressure. Pressure is simple force per unit area. Force per unit area means if you divide force by area, then you get the pressure for that force. Its symbol unit, this SI unit is Pascal. There are many applications of pressure. Suppose your school bag having large strips area so that you can feel less pressure, and the all pins are very sharp and at one end, so they can easily punch into the paper. So there are multiple example of pressure where we decrease the area to increase the pressure, or if we want to decrease the pressure, then we have to increase the area. After that, thrust is nothing but the perpendicular force applied by any fluid or liquid on an object. It is always perpendicular to the surface of the object. Okay, this is written here also. Next is application of pressure, that we have studied, and you have also studied these type of application in your lower classes, that is 9th class. Next is Pascal law. This is the basic law which we used to transmit the pressure or transmission of a pressure. So what it means, pressure is transmitted in all parts equally, means if you apply pressure at one of the end of any system, then that same pressure will go in all the parts of that system. So suppose this is an example that we have to study in Pascal law. If we apply a force here, then pressure is equal to force is F, area is A, force per unit area. Now same pressure will transmit here. Here pressure is equal to your force is 2F, area is 2A. So it will become F by A, same to this. Let's see this. This is pressure is equal to force per unit area. So this will also become force per unit area. So we can see that pressure will be transmitted equally in all the part. This is known as Pascal law. We can measure here the pressure using the pressure meter. Next is hydraulic lift. It is the simple application of your Pascal law. We have studied just Pascal law. So hydraulic lift is a simple application of your Pascal law. What we will do in this, there is a mechanical system to lift the heavy objects. You have seen at the car service center that heavy object can be easily shift by a simple mechanism that is known as hydraulic lift. What we have to do? We have to apply a pressure here, and according to Pascal law, same pressure will be gone to the other end. Same pressure will go to the other end. So we can see P1 is equal to P2. So if this is P1 and it is P2, then according to this equation, P1 is equal to P2. What is the value of P1? P1 is simple force applied here and area of this piston. So this is F by A, and pressure P2 is force upon this area. So if we want to calculate this force capital F, then by using cross multiply F dot A, sorry, capital A divided by small A. So we can see if this area is large, as you can see from the diagram, this area is very large. So as compared to this area, A is very, very greater than A. So we can simply say that F is greater than small F. So a small force applied here will produce a large force at the other end. So this is the simple application of hydraulic lift. Second is hydraulic brakes. These are used in your automobile, or you can say in trains. In this also we use a simple liquid, and at one end we applied the force, then at the other end the larger force will produce at the other end, and your automobile can be stopped easily. Next is your atmosphere and atmospheric pressure. This is simple that we know. In lower classes you have studied about the atmosphere. Atmosphere means the air present around the earth. So as we know that gravity is more near the earth's surface, that is 9.8 meter per second square. It is at the surface of earth. As we move in upward direction, then value of this gravity will be reduced. So we can say that as we go up, the control of gravity on the gases will be less. So the density of gas will decrease at we go at a higher height. So in this order your pressure will decrease. So we can say that as we move in upward direction, pressure will be released, pressure will be low. This is simply due to the gravity is decreasing in the upward direction. So atmosphere has many layer. In lower classes you have studied, that is stratosphere, ionosphere, mesosphere. There are many layers up to some ranges. Then atmospheric pressure. So the air present around the earth, exert a pressure on us, or you can say on every object present at the surface of earth, that is known as atmospheric pressure. Yani ki pressure exerted by the atmosphere present around the earth is known as atmospheric pressure, and at the surface it is calculated as 1.013 × 10⁵ newton per meter square, or simple pascal. This much is the pressure at the surface of earth. Next, a Trousley experiment. It is used to find the pressure at the surface of earth, or you can found pressure at any point. So what you have to do? You have to take a simple container, and in this we filled it by a liquid that is known as mercury. Now we will take a simple tube, thin diameter tube, and we filled mercury in this, and we put it in opposite side. So open end will be at mercury and closed end will be at the upper part. So we will see that your mercury level will lower down up to a limit of 76 centimeter from this end. This value is 76 centimeter, and this complete tube length is 100 centimeter. So this is your 76 centimeter. So what we have to look here, that above this surface, the mercury in the container, here is air. and here also in the empty portion there is also air. So both side air means both side pressure is same. So there is no more drop of mercury in the tube. So simply we can say that this is equal to atmospheric pressure. So we can measure simple by using the formula of pressure, that is h rho g. H is the height, rho is the density, g is the gravity. So height in this tube is 76 centimeter. I have converted it into meter. Then your density of mercury, it is 13.6 × 10³ kg per meter cube, and value of gravity on the surface of earth is your 9.8. So by simply solving this equation we get this value. That was study in last slide. So atmospheric pressure on the surface of earth is simply 1.013 × 10⁵ newton per meter square. Next is height of atmosphere. So if you want to calculate up to what range there is atmosphere around the earth, then you will use simple this formula, that is of pressure. So we have used one side your air and other side is your mercury, because one surface is your of mercury and one surface is your of air surface. So we have to simply find the height of the atmosphere above the earth surface. So this is the height and this is density of air and this is your gravity, and on the other side this is height of a mercury column, that is 76 centimeter. After that this is density of mercury and this is your earth gravity. So by this formula if we calculate the height of atmosphere, it will come around almost 8 kilometer. That is exact value is 7951 kilometer, but it is approximate 8 kilometer. After that density is very very less, so we can assume that atmosphere only exists almost up to 8 kilometer from the surface of earth. Next, pressure exerted by a liquid. The simple topic which have study in 9th class, that every object when go inside a liquid it will be exerted, it will exert a pressure by the liquid. So we have to study the formula in plus one class, and this is only due to the gravity. If there is no gravity, then there is no pressure exerted by a liquid. So we'll simply take a cylindrical container. In this there is a liquid, and if we assume a simple imaginary cylinder in this part, means suppose this is an object of radius r and height h. Suppose the force on the upper part which is acting downward is F1, and force on the lower part which is perpendicular upward is F2, and area of this cylinder is a. Then weight of the liquid in the cylinder, which we have assumed, it should contain some liquid. So the weight of liquid which is always perpendicular downward, mg. So this is mg. So we can simply convert it into volume into density. Mass is volume into density. G is simply G. Volume, volume is nothing but the area into height, or you can say length. So I have converted volume into AH. This is density and this is your gravity. Now force at end A. This is first end and force is F1. So force is simple pressure multiplied by area, which will be perpendicular downward. Then total force at A means P1 into A plus mg, that is perpendicular downward due to weight. Now at the other end, that is at point B, the pressure is simply P2 into A. P2 is pressure at here and area is same A. This is upward. In equilibrium, net force is zero, means if this cylinder is have its position here only, then we can say it is in equilibrium position, and equilibrium position net force is zero, means total upward and downward force will be zero. So we can simply say that F1 plus mg minus F2. Minus F2 is due to the opposite direction, this is upward direction of F2, is equal to zero. Now we simply put the value of these parameters. Now by taking simple difference, P2 minus P1 is equal to h rho g. P2 minus P1 is nothing but the pressure difference between the two points. Look at here, from this point and this point, this is the pressure difference is equal to h rho g. If gravity is zero, if there is no gravity, then P2 minus P1 will become zero. So pressure difference is only due to the your gravity of earth. So this is a simple example you must see in many books, that if you have three different container of different shape, but their height of volume in all is same, then which will exert the more or less pressure? Your answer will be that all the container will exert the same pressure, because pressure depend only on the height, not on the shape of the container. So all three container will exert the same pressure. So if you want to calculate the pressure any depth h, then you will use, this is pressure at the surface, that is atmospheric pressure, and simply use pa plus h rho g. You will add your pressure by atmospheric pressure to find the pressure at any depth h, at any depth of height h. So p is equal to pa plus h rho g. Next is Archimedes principle. This also you must have learned in 9th class, that is, if you put any liquid or if you push any object in a liquid, then weight loss by the object is equal to weight of the liquid displaced by it. Means loss in weight of any object is equal to weight of the liquid displaced by this object. So we have to simply find its proof. So let's see. This is a container which is having any type of liquid. If this is an object of height h, suppose force F1 at this surface is, and at this surface force is F2. The surface, upper surface of this object from the surface of this container is at height h, and area of this object is A. Then pressure at the upper surface, pressure means force into area, or you can say simple, your h rho g, this is the pressure, not the force. Pressure is h rho g. H for this surface is x, rho is density, g is the gravity. At the lower end, this is x plus h. So you will simply convert x into x plus h rho g. Then force on the upper face, p1 into a, we simply convert your area is A and pressure is your x rho g from there. This is on upward direction. And then your at the lower face F2 is your P2A. P2 is your this x plus h rho g multiply by area. As we know that F2 is greater than F1. If F2 is greater than F1, then object will try to move in upward direction. So if F2 is greater than F1, then net force is in upward direction. So thrust, or you can say upward force, is given by difference of these two forces, F2 minus F1. This is F2 and this is F1. So you will simply get A rho hg, and here A into H is nothing but the volume into density into gravity. So this is the difference in weight. So W2 is the apparent weight, that is weight after loss of weight. W1 is your real weight, and this is the loss in weight, or simply the weight of the liquid displaced by the object. Next, your practical application of Archimedes principle. With the help of this, you can find the volume of any object by the given formula which we have studied just now. Second is specific gravity of an object. This is nothing but the original weight divided by reduced in weight. Next, your condition of flotation of an object. We simply know that if the density of object is less than liquid, then it will float. If density of object is more than the density of liquid, it will sink. And if both are same, then object will sink and will float lower on the lower part of the surface of the earth. Next is viscosity. Viscosity is nothing but the resistance offered by a liquid. Every liquid which is viscous in nature will produce a resistance to the object which are flowing in that. So, we have to simply study the viscosity. So, what we have to do? We have to assume that a liquid which is flowing on the surface. So, this is the solid surface, you can assume the earth, and this is your layers of the liquid which are flowing. This is the surface area, means top layer of your liquid. Now, as we know that the lower part of the liquid will move with a slow velocity, and as we move in upward direction, the velocity will increase. So, we can assume two different layer P and Q. One is at a distance of x from the surface and second is from x plus dx distance. P layer has velocity v and Q layer has velocity v plus dq. This is greater velocity as we have moved in upward direction. So, change in velocity per unit length is known as velocity gradient. So, dv by dx is nothing but the velocity gradient. Now, viscous force applied by the liquid is directly proportional to the area of the contact, means the area between the two layer which is in contact, directly proportional to area of contact A. Then directly proportional to rate of change of velocity per unit distance, or you can simply say velocity gradient. So, this is dv by dx. So, if we remove this proportionality sign, then we will get this eta. Negative sign is due to the force in opposite direction of the velocity. So, F will become minus eta A dv by dx, and if we assume area is unit and velocity gradient is also unit, then your coefficient of viscosity, eta is the coefficient of viscosity, is numerically equal to the resistance offered by the liquid, or you can say simply viscosity of the liquid. Now, practical application of coefficient of viscosity. So, if you know the viscosity of a liquid, then you can use that liquid in a particular application. Suppose the lubricant used in the machines. So, if we know that how much its viscosity and up to which temperature it can work, so we can use that lubricant in your machines or automobile. Second is buffers. It is nothing but to absorb the jerk which is applied due to the automobiles. Next is damping. It is also used to control the your vibration of any object. Next is shape and structure of molecule. Viscosity also help us to study the shape and structure of a molecule. Next is Poiseuille formula. This is used to study the flow of liquid. By Poiseuille formula, we can study the flow of a liquid in a tube. So, if this is a tube and liquid is flowing in this tube, then you can study simply how much amount of liquid is coming out from the tube. So, it will depend upon certain parameters. So, volume per second flowing in a tube is given by, volume per second flowing in a tube is given by directly proportional to the pressure difference, means difference of pressure at both the ended. Second, inversely proportional to length and directly proportional to the 4 power of your radius, and inversely proportional is to your coefficient of viscosity. So, if we add all these parameters, then we get V directly proportional P R raised to power 4 divided by eta L, and constant is your K. This is your proportionality constant, and its value is given by pi by 8. So this Poiseuille formula is used to study the rate of flow, or you can say rate of discharge, or are same things, that is volume per second, rate of flow, or you can say rate of discharge, all are same things, means how much amount of liquid coming out from a tube. Next is your Stokes' law. It is used to find the terminal velocity in a viscous liquid, means if there is a viscous liquid and there is a viscous force, then if any object is dropped in that liquid, then after some time the object will attain a terminal velocity. So we have to find that terminal velocity in this. So simply the viscous force applied by any liquid is given by, this is direct formula, F is equal to 6 pi eta rv. Here 6 pi is constant, eta is your coefficient of viscosity, r is radius, and v is your velocity, that is your terminal velocity. Now to study the Stokes' law, we have to simple assume some condition, that is flow should be streamline flow, means every part of its component of liquid should flow with a uniform speed or same speed. Pressure is uniform, all along the pressure is uniform in a tube or in a container. Liquid contact to the wall should be at rest. Uniform area of your liquid, no gravity effect on the liquid, and liquid should have small shearing stress, means we can, if we want to compress the liquid, then it can be compressed and it can also regain its shape if we remove the force. So these are some basic condition which we should use. Now to find the expression of terminal velocity. Now suppose this is your any liquid or any fluid. If any object is dropped in this, if this is any object, then as we know that weight is perpendicular downward, that is mg, and upward thrust is your simple mass into gravity, mass is simply your volume into density. So we have converted it, volume is 4 by 3 pi r cube, and rho is sigma, it is its density. And similarly here volume is 4 pi r cube, and this is your density and this is your gravity. Now weight mg, we have converted it into volume into density, it is perpendicular downward. And thrust, which always in the upward direction, and this is equal to 4 by 3 pi r cube sigma into rho. Sigma is the density of the object, because upward thrust is on the object. Next is apparent weight. Apparent weight means loss in the weight. It is nothing but the your actual weight minus upward force exerted by a liquid on the object. So we simply put this value, this is mg and this is your up thrust. Then viscous force is also in upward direction, it is opposite to your flow of the object. So this is given by 6 pi eta rv. Then in equilibrium, if we take the direction of forces applied in different direction, then in equilibrium we can say that this apparent weight is should be equal to the viscous force, means this is equal to 6 pi eta rv. So 4 pi r cube into g, rho minus sigma is equal to 6 pi eta rv. From here we can easily calculate the terminal velocity attained by any object in any fluid. So if we know your densities and coefficient of viscosity of liquid, then we can find easily your terminal velocity. So this is first part of this chapter, and in next part we will study our remaining chapter.
स्टेशन हो गई है।
हेलो।